liars fighting for Osho's visa, and all this hassle, and finally he has to leave America, got arrested. You would like to share about all this?
So, Ma, in Rajneesh Puram, a few days ago, you were telling us about how the mamas used to come and make things.
Yeah. Yeah, in Rajneesh Puram, one thing was very beautiful. It was, I will say, an experiment of Osho, where non-possessiveness, everything belongs to the commune, nothing belongs to us. Even our children, our any small possessions, everything belonged to the commune. It was a very uplifting feeling for me. Because my background, I had lived in a small family and everything is my daughter, my husband, my house, my car, everything is my. And I reached to the commune and it is everything belongs to the commune. And there were no locks in the houses, there were no locks in the closets, everything was open. And the people who were caretaking of that place, for example, if one day you reach your room in your house and there is a note there, beloved, you are no more living in this house. Enjoy the new space, this. And you see that your things are already moved, nothing is there. So, whatever the address is, you go back, pick up the bus and reach there in your new house. Everything is like your bed is done, your closet is there, everything is there, very properly, very beautifully. Things were very organized and very beautiful, very systematic, and so much love and so much care between each other. It was like our home, we were making our home, our city, our commune. A feeling of oneness was very much there. And sometimes you come and open your closet and things are missing. And then you read a note, beloved, you had too many beautiful things, time to share. And they are gone, already gone. And then you will see one time I saw Gayan dancing around Osho and I knew that this chiffon sari belongs, one time belonged to me. But it was very beautiful feeling. You somehow, I think none of us felt bad about it. It was an experiment which we all enjoyed and could see that. And also there was one thing that if somebody's parcel is coming and somebody is getting things and you could, anybody could come. I know that one time my parcel came and my husband had sent a very huge parcel of clothes, but they were all Indian clothes which were not even suitable while working, and but they were all very beautiful. And I was opening the parcel and one of my friend came, Vitna, Haritma, all these friends, they came to see me and they said, oh, what beautiful clothes, oh, I love to have this. I said, have it. The other one will say, can I have this one? Just for twice. Yeah, you can wear it and then when you are finished with it, you can give me back. And it was always like this. I could also go and say to anyone, oh, I like this, you would like to wear it? Yeah, okay, I will bring you there. And everybody will share like that. It was very, like, in one way, as if children are playing and living together. There was nothing mine and nothing this, and there was no comparison always. I remember that Priya, I have given her always the best. I had it and I love to, like, pamper the kids also. And I always gave her very beautiful clothes. And on the ranch, for years, I could not buy anything for her. And sometimes she will not have even proper socks of one color. And she never complained, she never even felt that she doesn't have. She never came to me that, "Mama, I don't have good duvet to." She was sharing with Disha, with Nandan's daughter, the room, and Disha's father will send her a big, huge parcel of beautiful duvet, of beautiful new design jackets, socks, everything. And she never received anything, she didn't have anything. And but she never complained. And whenever she wanted to wear, she could wear Disha's clothes. And it was all fine. It was not a big issue that, "Oh, I don't have, oh, my father sent me, you ask your father." No, nothing was like this. If Priya wanted to wear a jacket, she will say, "Disha, I want to wear this jacket." "Yeah, yeah, you wear it." This was also a very beautiful experience that with Priya also, she was living separately with her age group, teenagers, and there was she was very well taken care by the people who were taking care of the teenagers, taking care of the kids. She never felt like that, "Oh, I miss the house feeling, I miss my grandma, I miss my papa, I miss you. You used to take care of me so much, now nobody takes care." Not like that. It was somehow very much love and care was prevailing. That part in the commune was very, very beautiful on the ranch. I learnt a lot in a sense because I was very shy housewife in one way, that to mix up with all kinds of people from so many different countries. Like on the ranch, I think we were from maybe 67 countries, people were living there, and we were all living in one unit. And to understand their way, their conditioning, to be friendly with them, to eat so many different kinds of foods, to be flexible, to enjoy everything, and you can shower your love, you become very good friends, and the next month that person you hardly see him because he is gone or she is gone. And you will see her maybe after lunch time or any time, just a glimpse of her. And it was in a that kind of that you can become very good friends, and also it's natural that the person will go because there's so much change was all the time happening. Change was very much there. And work was like a worship. It was. And one thing I very much loved in the ranch, that every morning when we used to start the work, we will do gachamis. And we will all sing together in the department. They are 100 or 200 or 50, whatever people are there. They will all gather together. And before we start the work, we will all sit down and we will close our eyes and remember why you are here. So there was always a voice inside that I have come for my growth process and I don't want to miss the chance. And then we will all sing together, "Buddham Sharanam Gacchami, Sangham Sharanam Gacchami, Dhammam Sharanam Gacchami." We bow down at the feet of the Master. We bow down to the commune of the Enlightened One, and we bow down to the truth of the enlightened one. And this was very beautiful experience. And always in the end, when we were leaving, we will all get together, wash our faces, wash our hands, sometimes just to take shower, and then we all get together. And again we do gachames, again to just remember why you are here. It was very beautiful. I think that these kind of little things made it possible that we could go through the whole experience. So Osho was all the time in silence in all these years, and he was not speaking publicly, but of course he was speaking to whatever was needed, to Sheila, to Vivek, or sometimes he will call somebody, like I have expressed few times I went there to see him. And then all these legalities started, and Osho was not given the visa to live there, and in the end he had to leave the country, America. And it was quite clear, the case was going on, that he might be leaving to India. So they were trying all the visas getting done for all the caretakers. Osho's personal caretaking staff, I think, had 12-13 people, and they were, but Indian government was not giving them visa even to enter into the country. So Hasya, who was at that time Osho's secretary, she asked that, I am concerned that you are going to India and Lakshmi is already there searching for a place where you will be staying, and all your staff, personal caretaking staff, are Westerners, and only the cook Mukti is Indian. So except Mukti, who was cooking for him, all the other caretaking staff belong to different countries than India. So Indian government was not giving them visa. So she was concerned, and she said, you, Bhagwan needs to pick up some Indians who can take care, because it's little dicey and I'm concerned. And Osho said, you go and tell Neelam, and she should come in Lao Tzu house and learn from Vivek, Shunyo and Devraj, the medical, how to take care, and she will manage. And Hasya said that, look, it is 13-14 people who are taking care, and one Neelam won't be able to do that part. And tell me few more names so that I feel comfortable. He said, Neelam knows, she will, you don't worry, she will manage. And Hasya knew me, because she used to be friendly with Vinod and we knew her. But she called me and she said, before I tell you the message, I want to know a little bit about you. How long do you know Osho? So you tell me your life story first. So I tell her, and then she says, why he is so much confident that you can do anything? I said, I don't know. I have not actually worked for him, and I'm not I'm not feeling very even good about it, that I can take good care of him. She said, but he is very much relaxed. And I said, one thing I can say, that I'm very much relaxed around Osho. I never feel, some people say that, oh, I feel very tight and I feel very relaxed. His presence always relaxes me. I have never felt like some people feel tense. She said, okay. So then she gave me the message, and then I was called in Lao Tzu house. Of course, Vivek was in a bad mood and she did not want to talk. And Shunyo, gave me the whole description how it is taken care, and I was writing my notes, and then Amrito came and he was telling me how to take care of his body, and I was writing my notes and all that, how to do the laundry and how, like, his days there, all that. So I was writing my notes, and then I was called and I was told that any day Osho has to leave, and you are not supposed to tell anybody, not even to your roommate or to your friend or to your daughter, nobody. Within 1 hour, we will give you 1 hour notice. So whatever minimum things you can, you pack your things and leave it. And with 1 hour notice, you will need to come. So then after a few days, I was called and left with Osho and came to India with Osho's family was there. First we came back to Delhi and we stayed for one night there, and the next morning we flew to Span Resort, Manali, and there Lakshmi was there, arranged everything, which was a beautiful resort,